got it, yeah.
Oh, there you go.
Good evening and welcome to The Connection. How's everybody doing this evening? Outstanding. Very good. I like that. I like that attitude. That's good. That's good. Well, it's sure nice to be back. Annual conference went off without a hitch. Everybody was fine, and it was a great time. We had a Korean band, Korean group of pastors there that was very inspiring, singing one of my favorite songs, and we're going to sing it here this evening. It was very inspiring. We got a concert from B.B. Wyman's on Friday night, which was a very good time, and it was a very blessed event. I was really enjoyed myself there. The overall conference was a good thing. It was very uplifting and very encouraging. We've lost a bunch of churches through disaffiliation,
the theme.
Hang on just a second. Where do I do with my paper? I have to write stuff down. Connect was the theme. And so being the connection and connect being the theme of the annual conference, which was very good, connect and more Christ-like inside and out. It was our theme of the conference, and it was good, and it made us feel all much more connected as we went along. We had 75 churches that disaffiliated this year, but we are still alive. We are still alive. There was lots of people there. I got to reconnect with a bunch of pastors that I hadn't seen in quite a while, and it was a wonderful event. It really was, and we enjoyed having several folks there from Bolivar, and it was a nice time. We had a good time, and it was a very blessed. It was long, and by the time I got home on Sunday, I was tired, but it was good, very refreshing. So there's your update on the conference, and so it's glad to have everyone here, and I want to throw a shout out to Jody and Mark and everything that they have done and filling in for me and Victoria and building slideshows and all of the things that they did this last week. It was a great thing, and it was blessed. And so I appreciate everything that everyone has done to fill in for me and Victoria as we were off at conference. Victoria didn't go to conference, but she live streamed it at home. And if any of you are on the connection page, there was a link out there that you could have poked on the link, and you could have followed it also through the live stream and watched the whole conference except for the clergy session. I don't believe that they live streamed that one, but they did most of it. Hi, Linda.
Hi.
Hi. How are you? Well, it was a great event. It was a great event. Let's stand and worship. Until I rise like the morning, wake up in the arms of glory, to finally see the sun above the pouring rain. Till I fall into surrender, healing hands, and remember there's a river on the other side of pain. I'm gonna better day coming, I know. Rejoice, Please. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, mighty God, boy, it sure would be good to be back home. Thank you, Lord, for all that you have done for us, dear Father. We ask, dear Father, that you would be with us, dear Lord, in this service and stir that Holy Spirit that you put inside of each one of us, dear Lord, that we might receive your words. We ask, dear Father, that you would always give us that joy that you give us. Only you can pour out your grace and your honor and your glory on us, Lord. And we glorify your holy name because you are the giver of all. We ask, dear Father, that you would be with us in this service, dear Lord. Heal our hearts and move us forward. We ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen. This King of glory that pursues me with his love and haunts me with each hearing of his softly spoken words. My conscience a reminder of forgiveness that I need. King of glory who offers it to me. Who is this King of angels? Oh, blessed Prince of Peace, revealing things of heaven and all its mysteries. It's ever longing for his grace in which to stand. Who is this King of glory, Son of God and Son of Man? His name is Jesus, precious Jesus. King of my heart, King of glory. Who is this King of glory?
and wisdom beyond measure. The gracious King of Kings, the Lord of earth and heaven, the Creator of all things. He is the King of glory. He's everything to me.
Our God. This is the one they done at conference, and it was just very inspiring.
You know, and Pastor Michael brought up the point. I did attend the conference. I was there in spirit, and I was attending online virtually. But when they did this song, it was so powerful and moving, because when they did it, they brought up three Korean pastors who actually stood in the front and sang it in Korean, while we in the audience were singing it in English, and then we melded together and sang it, and the power of it and the beauty of it. It wasn't like they were all the praise and worship team, but those pastors came up and did it, and it was so powerful and it was so moving that if you saw it, I was moved to tears, because I could feel the Spirit moving in my own home through what they were doing. And so when you think of who we are in the body of Christ, how great is our God, was really highlighted this last week at conference.
Amen.
The splendor of the King, majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, it trembles at his voice. How great is our God, sing with me, how great our God, and all will see how great is our God. Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, the beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great, how great is our God. Name above names, worthy of all praise, my heart will sing, how great is our God. How great is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all
Good today. Where have you seen God this week?
Oh, well, last
all,
night
don't
was.
I'll jump in there at once. Go ahead, Mark.
Last night was actually, it's been going on for a couple of days. Thursday night was a dog show out of the Polk County Fair, and then we helped with the poultry show last night, and just seeing people bringing their kids out to enjoy and to participate in the bounty that God has given us. And the people that pitched in and helped set up in the morning, in years past we've worked that, and it's been a chore to get everything set up, but people just pitched right in and set everything up, and it was really nice to have that time to work with people and time to have people help you. And it was really nice for me.
Nice. Very good. That's a good one to participate in for sure. Has anybody else got one?
Well, at our annual conference, to see a room filled with faithful Christians and the love that each one shared when we sang and when we sat quietly and when we prayed, there was that spirit of unity in the room, and it was God was there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Brendan,
absolutely. Brenda's got one back there. Or Logan's got one. Okay. One of them's got one.
Okay. I see God every day in the weather and in my kids. I'm so thankful for my family. And I know 30 cc's are in an ounce, in case you guys don't know that, but Logan now is able to take 15 cc's, which is half of an ounce, of by mouth. And also tonight while we were singing, he said God, just as plain as anything.
Nice. We're going to get him to sing in here one of these days, I'm sure of it.
All right, Logan.
Lord, do you have one?
So I'm facing some important decisions in my life, and last Sunday and Monday, I was just really hit with this really big feeling of anxiety about these things that I'm needing to do, and you know, I want to praise God for having godly friends.
There
because,
we go. There we go. That's good.
You know, I Monday afternoon, I went to one of my friends, and I told her what was going on, and I told her I needed her counsel and her prayer, and she took about 45 minutes out of her work day to sit there and counsel with me and pray with me, and you know, I really want to thank God today for godly friends.
Amen. There we go. Yeah, Christian support is a huge thing in our lives for sure. I'll always be thankful for those people for sure. Has anybody else got one? A joy, a concern, a prayer request?
I have two, but I'll get to the other one after the service with Michael.
Okay.
I want to praise the Lord for the successful heart surgery for Moxie Garrison.
Oh, okay.
I heard that on Facebook, I think last week or within this week, and mm-hmm. I just wanted to say I'm happy that she's recovering well, and she made it back safe, I believe. I don't know that for sure, but I believe. And I'm just very happy for her.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, there's always good praise there for sure. People that have recovered and illness, and go ahead.
A family member who has had foot surgery, and they went through it good, and they seem to be doing all right.
Nice.
They're in a little bit of pain, but
praise.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And prayer for
amen. Prayer for quick healing too. There we go. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Very nice. Does anybody else got one? If not, let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll follow this by the Lord's Prayer. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, mighty God, we come before you once again today. Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for all the different ways that we see you at work in our lives and in the world around us. We ask, dear Father, that for your blessings, dear Lord, of all of the different things that we've seen today, and the prayer of healing and your grace and your comfort to be upon them, dear Lord. We ask, dear Father, that you would continue to bless us and continue to move us forward, dear Lord, as Logan learns to sing. We ask, dear Father, that you would help us always to shine that light of Christ into all of the dark places of the world. We ask, dear Father, that you would be with us as we come together to pray the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we come into this time of tithes and offering, I would like to thank each one of you for your support of the United Methodist Church here in Bolivar, Missouri. It takes a little bit of support to do the things that we do. I was going over our ministries and stuff that the Bolivar United Methodist Church is participating in our community and the community around us, and we are reaching a lot of different people, and we are participating in a lot of different stuff in our community. And so thank you all for everything that you do and all of the stuff that you do to support the United Methodist Church. If you're involved, so thank you so very much for all of the things that you do. If you're not involved, there's many ways that you can get involved. We support a lot of different things in the community. There's a whole list of them there at the office. And if you would like to donate, we don't pass the basket here at the Connection. You can drop a check in the basket as you come or as you go, as you would like. If you're joining us online, there's always a place that you can poke the button and donate online, or you can drop a check by the office during regular business hours, or you can send something in. So thank you also very much for everything you do. Some of us, we're all not monetary givers. Some of us are givers. Some of us give of our heart, and some of us give of our time. And so there's all different ways that you can be involved, and you can give to your community around you. You don't have to be rich to give. You just have to give. Got to give love. Got to give that connection. Got to give that lifting up to other people. That's giving. That's giving to the church. And the church is us. The church is us, the body of Christ. If you join with me in the prayer of abundance. Oh, gracious, merciful, and abundant God, with thankful hearts, we give you our praise, our offerings, and all that we are. Let the world see your generous nature working through us. Make us a reflection of your love. Amen. We've been talking about visioning here for quite some time, and as we have been thinking about visioning and where we are as the Bolivar United Methodist Church and what we look like 5 years down the road or 10 years down the road and what we do in the world around us and how we impact the world around us. I keep going back to something a dear friend of mine said to me four years ago now at this point, that loneliness was an epidemic. And I thought about it when she said it to me, and I thought, well, you know what, okay, well, whatever. Well, since that time, I have heard over and over and over again about loneliness. And it wasn't just her that was saying it. It was that I've heard news clips on it. I've heard a bunch of different places. And I don't know whether it's because she said it and it impacted me so heavily and it stuck in my head, so now every time I hear it, I pick it out, or whether it's really something that is relevant in our time. And I think as we vision and look at our future as the Bolivar United Methodist Church, we do a lot of stuff. Like I said, we do a lot of stuff. We've got our fingers in a whole bunch of stuff out there in our community. But I think that this epidemic of loneliness that has come up over and over and over again is a great point of impact for us as the Bolivar United Methodist Church, because it's not work. It's not work. You don't have to do anything to pick up the phone and call a friend or call a relative or just sit there and counsel with somebody and lift them up when they're having trouble or when strife and anxiety and suffering is going on. So it doesn't take much to stamp out this loneliness that's in our world. And so Victoria and I have been talking about it, and we've been thinking about it, and as we've been thinking about it, we fell upon this song, and Victoria is the one that brought it up, from 1974. It's called Lonely People. I hope you enjoy this, and you can sing along if you know it.
And I'll add this from a worship standpoint. You may recognize it, but the writer who wrote this song, and his name is Dan, gosh, it's escaping me, but
Peak,
thank you, of America. He became a Christian and started to grow in faith, and he took this song and he himself changed it with another artist so that it was a faith-based song. And it already made sense and it already spoke in terms of faith in a secular world when it came out. But before he passed away at the age of 60, Dan Peak changed the song to what we're going to use for praise and worship today.
Give up my
vision. Your scripture reading comes to you from the Gospel according to Matthew. Starts at chapter 9, verse 35, and it goes to 10:8, and it says this: Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into the harvest fields." Jesus called his 12 disciples to him, and he gave them the authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the name of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee's, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: do not go among the Gentiles, enter any towns of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message: the kingdom of God has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, and drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. This is prior to Jesus Christ's crucifixion and resurrection. And when I look at this piece of scripture and I think about all of the things that are going on around us in our visioning, I look at this and I say, wow, Jesus is putting forth a vision of what Christianity and the church eventually is supposed to look like. And so when I'm reading this, I go, oh, okay, so there's mirrored scriptures in Mark, and there's mirrored scriptures in Luke that talk about this very same spot. Now, in Luke's gospel, the comparison, he sends out 72. In Matthew's gospel, he sends out just the 12. Did you notice in chapter 10, the very first verse, it says, Jesus called the 12 disciples to him, and he gave them authority, poured out the Holy Spirit, giving them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. So he changes from disciples to apostles right here. The definition of a disciple is a student. You're a student of something. If you're a disciple of that of Christ, you're a student of Christ. When you're an apostle, you're one that is sent with authority to preach the word of God, to call out the kingdom is near. And I was like, okay, here's where this transition occurs. And so Jesus, on the job training type thing going on here, he realizes and knows that what's coming down the pipe at him. He knows what's going on. These disciples have been with Jesus for quite some time in Matthew's gospel, all the way from chapter 3. Chapter 3 is where Jesus was baptized, and then he starts picking his disciples and moving forward in chapter 3. And here we are in chapter 10, and now these disciples have been with Jesus for quite some time. They have seen him do miracles. They've seen him heal. They've seen all of these things that it starts out with. Jesus went through all of the towns and the villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When I hit that piece of scripture right there, I went, wow, okay. This loneliness that we've been talking about is almost like a disease or a sickness, isn't it? And it's not just in our community, it's all over. It's not just in our country, it's in our world. It's a sickness that is going on, a disease that is creeping into one place right after another. And I think about it and I go, okay, well, Jesus has given these disciples the authority to heal, to drive out demons, to do all of these things. It says down here at the bottom, it says, to heal the sick and raise the dead, cleanse those from leprosy and drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. And so what that says to me is we have been given, God's grace has been poured out upon us as Christians, as the body of Christ. We are the body of Christ in this world, and his grace has been poured out upon us. And he's telling us right here, as freely as we have been given, we should also freely give to others, because the magnitude of what Christ done for each and every one of us is greater than what we could ever do for someone else. And so we should be very free with the way we give and how we give. And so when we talk about the vision and we look at what Christ's example was for these disciples, and what they did when he sent them forward, he sent them right from here, and he said, I want you to go out, and I want you to heal the sick, cure the lepers. Does that sound like a vision statement to you? Does that sound like a vision statement to you when you start rolling those off of there? It did to me. For some reason or another, it sounded like something that was a vision of what God was doing. So he doesn't want them to go to the Samaritans, or he doesn't want them to go to the Gentiles. He wants them to go to the lost sheep of Israel. From everything that I can study and everything that I know, the children of Israel were supposed to bring the Messiah into the world to bring God to the rest of us. Now, when Jesus Christ came to this earth, he was part of that, right? He was Jewish. He was Jewish. And so the Jewish people, Jesus, still brought the Messiah to the rest of the world. Now, we all have free will, every one of us. And so some of them accepted him and went with the program, and some of them did not. And so when the Holy Spirit was poured out at Pentecost, and here's where I jump to from that spot. When the Holy Spirit was poured out at Pentecost, you had a whole group of Jewish people that were in the city for that time. Now, some of them, if you remember, some of them said, oh, well, them guys are drunk. No, it's 9 o'clock in the morning. We're not drunk. This is what's going on. Peter gets up and he, full of the Holy Spirit, he throws this blazing sermon out there. And when he gets finished with this sermon, the people that were there in Acts chapter 2, verse 36, it says this. I'll start at 36. Therefore, let all of Israel be assured that this God has made this Jesus, whom you have crucified, both Lord and Messiah. Verse 37 says this. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said, to Peter and the apostles, brothers, what can we do? They realized, all of a sudden, the light come on. They realized what they had done and the mistake that they had made. And Peter says this. Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sin. First step in visioning. First step in everything that we do is to repent. Repent. We should be, as Christian people, we should live in a state of repentance. Because you know what? We sin every day. We sin every day. We sin sometimes and don't even realize we're sinning. And so we should always live in a state of repentance because we're undeserving of the grace that God has poured out upon us. We're just undeserving of it. We're not. And so we got to this point and I went, okay. So when he says repent, then it says, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Second step in creating a vision. We have to be in line and align ourselves with the Holy Spirit. Critical. We have to be in a repentant state, and we have to align ourselves with the Holy Spirit before this can happen. And as we pray about it, and as we think about it, it says this, the promise is for your children and for all who are far off and for all whom the Lord our God will choose. Now, when he says this all of a sudden kind of opens the door, all of those that are far off and all of those that are called by God. After he says this, there were 3,000 were added to their number that day. The pouring out of the Holy Spirit upon those apostles, those disciples of Jesus Christ. It wasn't them who done it. It was the Holy Spirit working through them that done it. The 3,000 were added to them that day. In verse 42, it says this, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship and the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All of the believers were together and have everything in common. Why do you think that is? Because they had received the Holy Spirit, and that Holy Spirit works as the body of Christ, draws us together. We have everything in common through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. They sold their property and possessions and gave to anyone who had need. Now, I'm not standing here saying that you need to go sell your house and your car and all of that stuff and give it to the poor. This is telling us that you need to have a giving heart. Have a giving heart. Be in link with the people around us. Know what they need. Not just say, oh, well, that person needs this. I'm going to go do that for them. No. Connect. Our conference's theme this year is connect. We have to connect with others to know what they need. We can't go, oh, well, they need this. In our infinite wisdom, we know that they need this. We don't know that. We have to build a connection, and we have to build a connection with that person, that individual, or that group. We have to build the connection to know the needs of that person. And building the connection is key, is a key thing. And how to build a connection, if you have the Holy Spirit living within you, you are very receptive to others. and very receptive to all human beings, because let me tell you something about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit works in everyone, not just us Christians, because back here in Matthew's gospel, remember what it said? It said he gave them authority. And guess who was in that group? Judas. He was in the group. And he gave them authority. The Holy Spirit works. Whether you're a Christian, whether you're accepting of Jesus Christ, or whether you're not accepting of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit still is at work. Every day, they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all of the people. And the Lord added to their numbers daily those who were being saved. Now, here you go. Let me read that one more time. And the Lord added to their numbers daily those who were being saved. It didn't say the disciples. It didn't say the apostles. It didn't say the 72. It said the Lord added to their number. And the Lord added to their number because the Holy Spirit was working within them and through them, and God added to their number. Not them. Not them. So when we sit and we say, okay, well, we're going to do this for the community, and we're going to do that for the community, and we're going to do this for the community, and we don't engage the Holy Spirit prior to saying we're going to do this, that what we do, you might as well not do it. Because if you're not engaging the Holy Spirit and you're not building connections with those people that you think that you're going to do something for, you're stuff will fall flat, and it will absolutely do nothing for you. I guarantee you, I've seen it happen over and over and over again. We have to be the church that gets back to the basics. Back to the basics. This is why we're talking about the first church. We're talking about the first church because I want you to realize what the first church did, how their numbers increased. If we want to increase, if we want to see God at work in the Bolivar United Methodist Church, we have to get back to the basics of this Bible right here. We do. We have to get in line with the Holy Spirit. We have to figure out and make those connections out in that community and see what those folks need and what will draw them to us. And what draws them to us is the Holy Spirit that works within us. That's what it is. And so when we start talking visioning, and this is what we're going to do, this is not about strategy. This is not about tactics. This is not about any of those things. This is about us. And this is about us getting back to basics, relying on God, engaging His Holy Spirit that lives within us to help a community in need. Our vision should be start out with. This is the way we should start out this vision. We are a Holy Spirit driven church. That's what we got to be first. That's the first thing that we have to be. We have to be a Holy Spirit driven church. If this church is going to survive, if this church is going to be more than a social club, it's got to get back to the basics of what the Bible tells us to be and who God wants us to be. He wants us to engage the Holy Spirit. You will see an amazing thing happen when you engage the Holy Spirit. Praising God and enjoying the favor of all of the people. 3,000 gave their life to Christ in one day. One day. One day. After one sermon. One sermon. One day. A sermon powerful and filled with the Holy Spirit.
and a people living together, being the body of Christ. They had everything in common. They all moved together. The body of Christ on this earth, it's describing it right here. And we read through it and go, oh boy, that was great. Wow, that's wonderful. Glad. Wish our church could do that. We can. This can happen. And I fully believe that it can happen. I believe that God can move. I believe the Holy Spirit is alive and well in our world today. I know it because I can feel him. I can feel him right here. And he's there. And he's with us. He's with us. He's with us every day. We see him at work in our lives and in the world around us. And we're recognizing him. That's why we go through this every week. I go, where have you seen God this week? It's to help us recognize his work. He's a wonderful God, isn't he? Isn't he? Hi, Linda. He's a wonderful God. And when we open our hearts to him and we align ourselves with his Holy Spirit, we come together as one. All of a sudden, our love for one another and our support for one another, our other Christian friends, we support and we build. It's not just the United Methodist Church, I'm telling you right now. It's not just us. It's the Christ body. It's all of us together. And we go for this division, though. As human beings, you know, and it's just how we are, and I don't know why we got to be this way. Oh, we can't agree on everything, and we've got to. Okay, well, we're going to split off, and we're going to go over here, and we're going to start something new over there. You know what? We're all part of the body. We're all part of the body. Why can't we work together? Now, you know what? The devil, and I'm going to say this out loud, the devil has been around since the very beginning, since Adam and Eve in the garden, right? He knows pretty much every trick in the book, right? To get us not to do things together, to divide us. And a strategy in war and conflict is divide and conquer, right? It's been that way for years. Do you think the devil knows that? I think he does. Because he sets up division. He sets up division in our own United Methodist Church. You don't think he's here? He's here. And he's at work just like God is. And he's working as hard as he possibly can because he knows that one day Jesus is going to come back and he's going to be done. He has no more authority. He hasn't got authority over us now. Amen. He don't have that authority over us because we can say, get behind me, Satan, and he'll go. And he'll flee from you. He will. Or you can invite him in, go arm in arm with him. And he'll take you down a dark, nasty path. I've been there too. And it's the truth. It's the truth. But as long as he can keep us divided and not working together, and over two or three or five words or a stanza or a sentence in the book, it's not right. It's not right. It's just not. The United Methodist Church, our mission statement is making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And one of our statements is, do no harm. Do no harm. When we go through a bunch of division and craziness that we're going through right now, do you think we're harming people? I think we're harming people, don't you? I think we're harming people. Enough. That's enough. We don't supposed to. That's right. That's part of who we are. It says do no harm. We shouldn't be doing harm to others. We should be loving one another, supporting one another, talking to one another, helping them when they have problems. That's who we are, and that's who we're supposed to be. As Christians, conference was good. It was good. And there was a lot more elbow room there than there normally is, because we lost several. And it's sad. It really is sad. We've got a 2024 conference coming up, but we're still here, we're still living, and there's still hope for United Methodist Church in the world. We've still got a lot of work to do, a lot of work to do. There's an epidemic going on outside of these walls of loneliness that, brothers and sisters, we can help with. We can help with. We can. We can pick up the phone. We can make that connection. We're the connection. Oh, my God, look at us. That's our name. We're the connection. We can make that connection with others. It doesn't have to be work. We don't have to spin in circles, and we don't have to slave our days away. I started a deal, and it's not like it's a brand new deal. We don't have to reinvent the wheel, right? I started a coffee with the pastor down at my church in Climax Springs. And as we were going through this coffee with the pastor, and I was just getting to know my people, you know, I spend an hour with them on Sunday morning, and I don't know them very well. So I started coffee with the pastor so I can get to know my people. Don't know them like I know you folks. So I'd go to the restaurant. There's a restaurant right up at the end of the road. And so we'd go to this restaurant, and I'd go in there and sit down with this couple or this individual or that individual and have coffee, and we would discuss, and we would laugh, and we would talk. Well, it went from coffee with the pastor into, oh, well, let's go to breakfast. Our service is at 9 o'clock in the morning, so about 10 o'clock, you're about ready to eat, right? So we all meet up there at the restaurant for breakfast after church is over. And so now you've got 6, 7 couples, sometimes 8, meeting at the restaurant and eating together. Everything in common. We would talk and laugh. We didn't talk about each other or the person that didn't come. We talked about our lives and what things that we were going through, and our animals and our houses and our stuff, and just laugh and joke. I had a couple come into my congregation a few weeks ago, and they told me this. Well, we came down here, we stopped in at the restaurant up the street, and the lady that owns the restaurant up the street, we asked her if we were looking for a church. And the lady that owns the restaurant that we've been meeting at said, well, you know what? You may ought to go down to the Methodist church. Boy, they seem awful friendly and loving down there. Sure. Merv and Glenda came down to our church, and after the second, they'd been there 2 times, they attended 2 times, Glenda stood up in front of the church and she said this, we found our home. You guys are a loving, caring group. They go and eat breakfast with us over Sunday morning. Now, is that work? Going to eat breakfast ain't much work for me. I like to go eat breakfast. And so God working through us, here you go. Now here's the wrap up. God working through us. If he's working through us and within us, our work doesn't feel like work anymore. Our work feels like socializing and just getting together for a little bit of breakfast, you know? Our work is no longer work. And as we start looking at the way the church was formed, the very first church, we will see as we come along through this how God made them able to do the work. After you have 3,000 people, now all of a sudden, how are you going to take care of those 3,000 people, right? So as we look at the formation of the first church, we will see how God supplies every need that they had. Every need that they had. But that'll be a different sermon. Would you stand?
One day there'll be no more waiting left for our souls. One day there'll be no more children longing for home. One day when the kingdom comes right here where we stand, we will see the promised land. Ooh. One day there'll be no more lives taken too soon. One day there'll be no more need for hospital rooms. One day every tear that falls will be wiped by His hand, and we will see the promised land. Ooh, hallelujah. There will be healing from this heartbreak we've been feeling. We'll sing in the darkest, because we know the light will come and there will be healing. Hallelujah. One day there'll be no more anger left in our eyes. One day the color of our skin won't cause a divide. One day we'll be family standing hand in hand, and we will see the promised land. We will see the promised land. Hallelujah. There will be healing from this heartbreak we've been feeling. We'll sing in the darkest night, 'cause we know the light will come and there will be. Hallelujah. And there will be healing. Hallelujah. One day every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. One day when our tired and weary bones find their rest. One day when the power of evil's brought to an end, we will see the promised land. We will see the promised land. Hallelujah. There will be healing from this heartbreak we've been feeling. We'll sing in the darkest night, 'cause we know the light will come and there will be healing. Hallelujah. And there will be healing. Hallelujah.
All kinds of healing that can be done there, isn't there? Beautiful, beautiful. Well, this weekend, got Father's Day tomorrow. So happy Father's Day to you fathers. Juneteenth is on Monday. They're free. Freedom. Freedom. Beautiful. Beautiful. Think of these things and how far we have come, but how far we have still got to go. It's a wonderful thing. God at work in the world around us. We need to give Him ourselves to work through. Would you pray with me, please? Good and gracious Heavenly Father, mighty God, we come before you once again today, Lord. We just pledge our lives, our hearts to you. We ask, dear Father, that you would be with us, dear Lord, as we go out into the world, dear Lord, and reflect your light into a dark, world around us. We ask, dear Father, that you would be with us, dear Lord, and help us to draw others to us, dear Lord, that we might have many workers in the fields. Are ripe in the harvest, but the laborers are few. We ask, dear Father, that you would be with us as we go to our homes, dear Lord, and bless each and every one that is here and each one that is joining us online, dear Father. Give them a special blessing. We ask, dear Father, that you would be with us and help us, dear Lord, as we come together, as we vision for the future of the Bolivar United Methodist Church. Dear Father, help us to get back to the basics of the Holy Spirit's movement. In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray, amen. If you can't see the light of Christ in the world around you, be the light of Christ in the world around you. God bless you all. Thank you so very much for being here.